Hello. I have a special little quiz this morning. Buenos dias, good morning. Buolavinaka, maloa lele, welcome to worship. Glory calls us here this morning in so many ways. Thank you, Rick, for the beautiful medley on this wonderful, wonderful morning where we are celebrating in God's spirit several things. First of all, Juneteenth. Hallelujah that it is now a federal holiday. And that, for one thing, means that tomorrow our office will be closed, so just a reminder to you. But find a way that you can celebrate Juneteenth, the historic date when the slaves in Texas learned 2 years later that they were indeed had been made free. And so today we remember and honor this day as a time to remember that we are not yet free, and especially African Americans in our nation are not yet free. So let's celebrate that in a way that we can, especially today and tomorrow, but I would say the whole week, if you can find your way. I suggest supporting Black-owned business, make a change in your life, an intentional change that will help us all move forward toward emancipation for all peoples. So, reminder that our office will be closed tomorrow. We'll be back ready to serve you on Tuesday morning. And of course, a happy Father's Day for all of you who are fathers and who have shown fatherly love and given fatherly guidance and support to anyone in your life. We are so blessed with those who have taken on the ministry of fatherhood, right? Those who understand it as a calling from God, one in which they, like God, shape human lives for good. So let's give thanks for our fathers on this day, and I hope you find a way to celebrate any dad at hand, but especially to show them the love that they have shown to us. Our English language service continues here in the sanctuary at 10:30, and we have our Fijian language ministry worship at 1 o'clock. The Tongan Lotu, the Kalasi Aho devotion, is held on Sunday afternoons at 4 o'clock. We invite you all to attend any of these as you would like to, and especially to share with those who may not realize that we have these offerings in worship for each language group. Special welcome to those of you who are watching from home this morning, and we pray that you will be blessed by all that we offer on this day. You have in your order of service another little insert. I'm repeating this because some folks may have missed my intent. I have a few responses that I can work with. But what I'm asking you to offer us, thank you, Pamela, for offering a wonderful one last week, are stories of Jesus, not stories he told, but things about his life that have either impacted you or you've been curious about or you've wondered, what does that really mean to me or to us as Christian disciples, those who follow Jesus. So if you would just give that a little bit of thought this Sunday morning and place your offering in the offering plate, and I will be happy to address some of those as we move through our summer Sundays. Tell me the stories of Jesus. You remember that wonderful little children's hymn, don't you? Tell me the stories of Jesus. Scenes by the wayside. I always remember that one. Jesus was always on the wayside, wasn't he? Always on the move, going from somewhere to somewhere, at least as the gospel writers tell us. So if you'll share that with me, that would be wonderful. Also, just to remind you, now that we are back in worship together in the sanctuary and our choir is once again taking its much well-earned hiatus, we are back to having your choice for the first hymn on Sunday mornings. And what we'll do is we'll take the first and the last hymn. So when we get there, I'll be inviting you to share in that this morning. So please have something in mind that you can remind us of, and if you would please make sure that you say loudly the hymn number so I can repeat it for those of you who would like to read it, or you all need to read it from the hymnals. So whether it's the United Methodist hymnal or the Faith We Sing, just shout out the number and I'll make sure everyone sticks together. Would love to share some other announcements with you. Big thank you to Semi Lewniqila, who is our lay member, to the annual conference session, and he is bringing the conference session back to us this morning. So thank you, Semi, for your preparation in advance. And now I'm going to invite Carolyn Rokke, our liturgist, to come forward and lead you in the passing of the peace of Christ. Please stand in place as you are able.
Good morning on this bright and sunny Father's Day. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you. All right, let me invite you to welcome one another in the peace of Jesus Christ by any sign that you would like to. What a gift to be together God bless you. Let me invite you to take a seat because I have a little quiz for you. Yes, this is your call to worship quiz. And this is about annual conference. So I know some of you know a bit. Some of you are going to learn a bit this morning. This is, I like to give you heads up, trick question. How many times a year does the annual conference meet? You would be surprised. Like, you know, who's buried in, what is it, which? Grant's tomb, yeah, who's buried in Grant's tomb. How many times a year does the annual conference meet? It is actually a trick question. Oh, Kate Eccles, woo! Okay, flying colors for you. So it is a trick question because at one time it was annually, one time per year. But now it's been a little different. And so we have broken it into different parts, which have happened on different times of the year and different dates. So, Kate, I don't know how you know that, but boy, you're sharp. Okay, who are the members of the annual conference? Who are members of the annual conference? There's four categories. I'll give you a hint. Go ahead. All the clergy and lay pastors, right? Yes. Yes, lay people who are called lay members. They are not delegates. They are members of the annual conference. Others? Yes, it's an open meeting, and we actually invite lots of folks to come. And it can get pretty big. I don't know how many total this year. Did you hear a number, Semi? But, you know, we were still coming back. There can be, maybe at least 800 people around on any given day and time. Probably more like 1,000 who come and go. So there's lots of visitors. The other members of the annual conference are the leadership in the annual conference, those who lead the committees are members, as well as the conference staff people. So they are also, not all the conference staff people, but those who lead the larger bodies. Fran.
Are people who are staff at general boards and agencies from this annual conference also members?
I don't think so, but that's a very good question. She's asking whether people who are like executive secretaries of directors of general boards and agencies, whether they are automatically members of the annual conference if they come from this annual conference. I don't think so. Very often they are members because, like, Greg Berquist is already an elder here, but he leads our General Board of Higher Education and Ministry. But there are others, and I'm not certain about that in terms of lay folk. Good question. So you gave me homework, Fran. Okay. Three choices, A, B, or C. Clergy and laity meet together, separately, or both? Both is accurate. And nowadays, well, let me go on to the second question. We have been meeting in, let's see, in 2020 and 2021. True or false, the annual conference sessions were canceled during the pandemic. True or false? False, because we held them on Zoom, all of the sessions. And that's when we began to break them up into pieces and hold different parts of the annual conference session on different days on Zoom. And so some Zoom meetings are just for clergy. Some Zoom meetings are just for laity at times other than our regular June meeting. Now, when you watch, did anyone watch any part of this year's annual conference session? It was live broadcast. Thank you, Fran. So Fran will know that very often when the front table is shown with the bishop and the conference staff, behind the bishop at her shoulder is Paul Extrum-Fernandez. Why is he there? Two answers. A, because he's so good looking. Or because he functions as our conference parliamentarian. So how many for A? Oh, both. Thank you, Fran. And that just about does it. I want to encourage you to attend the annual conference session because you can. You're here in Sacramento. And if you have never attended it, just even a few hours on one day to see, Mariah saying yes, to see the quality of our worship life together. The music is awesome. And the preaching is wonderful, and it's just so good to see all of the people who are us. You know, sometimes people, you know, having served as a superintendent, people will talk about the conference. We literally are the conference. And so I want to acknowledge that and invite you to be part of the annual conference life in that way. It would be wonderful for you to just visit. And I hope someday you will take that opportunity. So thank you so much. Let's stand, and if those of you are ready on this side, who has one hymn for us to sing together? And I'm going to have to grab a hymnal. You all have hymnals, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Carolyn and I will grab a hymnal. Anybody ready on this side? Please stand. We'll sing First and Last. No one has one ready. This side.
Ah. Oh.
Wait. Kate said one. 361 in the hymnal. Oh, you got one, Carolyn? Okay. 361. What is that? Oh, Rock of Ages. Oh. Okay. Rock of Ages, 361. Let's sing the first and the last stanza, please, Rick. Thank you. Go ahead. This side, be ready. Next. 454. Keep your hymnal open. 454. Open my eyes that I may see. 1 and 3, please. Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. 454.
Thank you.
decide who's ready. Anybody for our last one? Nobody? Jane has another. Hold on, hold on. Give you one more 30 seconds. Sorry. Nobody? Okay, Jane. 288. Let's see. I love to be surprised. There's some I know by heart, the numbers. Ah, were you there? Thank you. 288. So 1 and 5. Verse, stanza 1 and stanza 5. Thank you. Were you there? Please be seated. And I don't see children with us this morning, so let's move to our time of prayer. We bring such full hearts every week because God's grace is so good for all of us. Again, we are asked to pray every week for one of our new efforts in reaching out and welcoming others into the kingdom of God and the way of Jesus. Let's give thanks and pray this week for Table Farm and Table Bread right here in Sacramento. This is our own new outreach, which has been started only, I believe, in 2020 or 2021 with the pandemic. I had the pleasure of working at Table Farm this week as I'm preparing for our discipleship experience. And it was a fabulous, fabulous way to serve God. So if you don't even need a green thumb, if you just want to help feed those who are hungry in our neighborhood. This is in Hollywood Park. It's in the back part of the property of St. Robert Church, right here in Hollywood Park. And there is a beautiful effort this summer going on with young people. The Table Farm Table Bread has offered a fellowship, I believe, for 5 young people who will work with a stipend this summer on learning to make bread and learning about the needs of people who are food insecure here in Sacramento. So let's pray for these marvelous Methodist Wesleyan ministries. For Table Farm and Table Bread, Lord, hear our prayers. I would ask you to hold in your hearts again all fathers. If you can, let's offer them a special blessing later this day. If you gather with family or friends, offer them a special blessing because you know how difficult it must be in this world to be a father, to be one who seeks to show young, impressionable hearts and minds what it means to be strong, to be a provider, to be one who guides with a loving hand, because there are so many options out there that are not healthy, not spiritually healthy at least, and emotionally healthy. So let's pray for our fathers. Lord, hear our prayers for those with the calling of fatherhood. Would ask your prayers for Jane Hing and her family. She lost her brother in Houston this past week, and also her sister-in-law here in the Sacramento area. So please be in prayer with our Jane and her family as she prepares to join them later this week. Lord, hear our prayers for God's comfort for Jane Hing and her family. For all those who understand themselves to continue to be in bondage, not only in our nation, but across the world. We know that bondage takes so many forms, so many ways. We know that even here in our nation that the opioid crisis has taken so many lives and holds so many more in bondage, so many ways that people, God's children, need to be freed. For all those who suffer from emancipation delayed, Lord, hear our prayers for their freedom. I would like to say a word. Some of you are aware that at our annual conference session, this is one of the years where we are preparing for Episcopal nominations and elections. It's an odd time for that because of the pandemic shifting the timing of the general conference, our global gathering, and therefore our jurisdictional conferences where Episcopal leaders, our bishops, are elected. During our conference session, there was a time before, shortly before the conference session, where people could be named as nominees by people who are members of the annual conference. And I want to share that list with you. There are, I think it's 18, it's got to be. Yeah, I thought it was 19, but it's an even numbered list. So I want to point out, some of you may know some of these clergy. Only clergy are, clergy elders are eligible for nomination and election as bishops. Bener Agtorap is one of our Filipino brothers. Myrna Bernadelle Huey went to seminary with me at Boston University. Elizabeth Brick is a pastor right here in the Sacramento area. She was at Woodland and now is at, Rancho Cordova. Blake Busick has been serving as one of our superintendents, Stacy Current as well. Georgia Dominguez has visited here. He's one of our staff people. George Ed Bennett is one of our elders. Renae Extrum-Fernandez would be me. Shinya Goto is our superintendent. Samuel Hong is also serving as a superintendent. Theon Johnson is one of our newer elders in the annual conference. He served at Glide, and now he's, one of our larger African-American congregations. Jeffrey Kwan is a professor who is serving as a seminary president. Ella Luna Garza, I'm sorry, I don't know her. Kim Montenegro is one of our elders. David New, you know, is also serving as a superintendent. As you can see, it's very popular to name the superintendents, to nominate superintendents. Matt Pearson is the pastor at Elk Grove, and Kristen Stone King is the pastor at Epworth Berkeley, thank you, and Dale Weatherspoon is also one of our African-American elders. So these are all elders in our annual conference. I want to let you know that what this means is that we have been invited into a process of spiritual discernment, which means we've been invited to a Zoom meeting in June, and at that meeting, I think they're going to share the process with us more fully. We are then asked to have, I think, a couple of dates. In September, we're asked to declare whether we will accept our candidacy and go forward to the November jurisdictional elections, and so then the month of September and October will be used for interviews by our delegation of this annual conference, and I'm not sure about the other delegations, so I think from other annual conferences. So I just want to assure you this is a timeline. There are no decisions to be made at this point. And I also want you to be aware, as I think many of you are not, that in 2008, I was nominated by my colleagues to be a candidate for Episcopal election, and that was a very, very different process than the process this year. This year, people could actually name themselves, or even one person naming you would put your name on the list. Before, you had to have, I think, 35 elders put your name up for nomination. So in 2008, I actually did, was a candidate at the jurisdictional conference for episcopacy, and obviously I was not elected. but there are a number of people who come from different annual conferences at the jurisdictional conference. But I want to thank Fran Eldridge for reaching out, understanding that these are very big and weighty decisions about our callings in our lives for those who are nominated. And I would ask, as Fran asks, for your prayers for all those who are nominated, and especially as well the congregations they serve, for those who are serving congregations who are looking at the potential that a pastor may be elected in November and then be leave their local church for service within the jurisdiction. Also, just a note so that you're aware, one is never assigned by the Jurisdictional Episcopacy Committee to serve in the conference you come from. So if any of the people named are elected a bishop in the jurisdiction, they will not serve in the California-Nevada Conference. They'll serve in one of the other Western jurisdictional conferences. So please hold all of these people and their congregations and their families in your prayers. Lord, hear our prayers for those in spiritual discernment. I had a delightful time with our Wilma, and she wanted to say hello. So here is Wilma Zanzi with that amazing smile that comes straight from her heart. So let's share our prayers of joy and love for Wilma Zanzi. For Wilma Zanzi, thanks be to God for her joy. And also, Florence Ness sends her her hello to Centennial people with her love. She is doing well now. She had been hospitalized a couple of times, and she sends her love to you all. For Florence Nuss, Lord, hear our prayers for her complete recovery and her strengthening. She lives now in the Santa Cruz area. I'd like to invite your prayers in this Gay or Queer Pride Month for all those who identify as LGBTQI or anywhere on that spectrum. I just want you to know that there are so many increases in hostility toward our brothers and sisters in Christ and our queer brothers and sisters. And I was hearing this week, just this week, that in Saudi Arabia, any rainbow-colored toys are being confiscated and banned, lest they influence homosexuality in children. The utter ignorance that continues in our world, that fuels the hostility, is something that we as Christians must confront. So let us do so with boldness, the boldness that the Holy Spirit demands of us. Lord, hear our prayers for those who suffer from the hostility toward GLBTQI people. And now will you join your hearts with me in prayer? So many ways that our hearts are filled this morning. Loving God, we come to you on this day of beauty, this day of warmth, of sunshine, and of love for one another. You keep calling us together. You not only call us individually, but you call us together over and over again to become and be the body of Christ, who reigns in our hearts as the risen one, and now we find ourselves empowered together to lift our voices in praise, in thanksgiving, and in advocacy, and in confrontation when you call us to our prophetic call. Oh God, we come as those who are so full of grace and thanks for those who show fatherly love, for those who open their arms to embrace the beautiful diversity that is your creation, for those who love your church and serve with such faithfulness and commitment in spite of all the ways we fail to be faithful. We come, our God, as those who seek to hear your will and your word for Centennial United Methodist Church as we carry your flag forward, forward to invite and welcome those who do not know your love and your grace, your compassion, and especially your justice. We turn aside, our God, from all those expressions of fate, hate, and fear that fills so many people, our neighbors. We pray, God, that you will lift us up as a witness, as a light, as a city set on a hill within a city set on a hill, to point your way to those who feel lost and abandoned. We pray, God, for those who continue to live and die on our streets, for those who struggle with needles and those who struggle with drugs, those who struggle with their loss of employment, those who do not know where and how they will pay their rent, those who scramble for food for their children. These are our neighbors, O God, and your children. Teach us the way to respond in your love with all that you have already given us, to reach out beyond our comfort zone, to dare to risk in your love. Send us as your people once again, as we lift our hearts to Jesus Christ and trust only in his grace, that it will be sufficient in our grief, in our longing, in our hope. And we pray now as Jesus taught his followers, his disciples, to pray, saying, Our Abba, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Praise God, I'm so happy to be here with you today. I want to say a happy Father's Day. We had an opportunity to sing this song, He, a couple of weeks ago, but I wasn't feeling well, kind of connected to me using this came right now. But I don't know if you ever experienced this, but when you see how God moves in certain ways and makes certain connections. So I wasn't able to sing this song, He, last time, but now I get to sing He today. And it seems so fitting because I see this song, He, as relating to our Heavenly Father and all the things that our Heavenly Father provides for us. So it seemed to be such a terrific connection. I hope you all feel that same way too.
Who rises
writes a symphony. He lights every star that makes the darkness bright. He keeps watch all through each long and lonely night. He still finds the time to hear a child's first prayer. Saint or sinner, call and always find him there. Though it makes him sad to see the paint the clouds and turn the gray to blue. He alone knows where to find the rainbow's end. He alone can see what lies beyond the bend. He can touch a tree and turn the leaves to gold. He knows every lie that you and I have told. Though it makes him sad to see the
Our gospel reading today is from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Pursue hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be arrogant, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Carolyn, for reading those words for us. And good morning, church. Once again, I stand before you as the member to the annual conference. And it is indeed an honor to be elected as the representative from this church to that meeting. It hasn't really been a year since when we last met. I think we are now adjusting to the more normal time, which is usually this time of the year. But last year we met towards the end of the year, so I think it's only been 6 or 7 or 8 months when we last met, and we're meeting again this month. As you heard, the conference is on the church website. The full videos are there, and information is there. If you want more details, please go to the website, the church website, and you can even watch the videos to see what Pastor Renae has been saying. And the experience I always get when I go to the conference is this overwhelming experience that tells me that we are not doing this alone, that we are part of this bigger group of people that's trying to do the work that we are called to do. Many times we, as a small church, you know, we get overwhelmed with what we're doing here, not realizing that there are so many more people just like us out there facing the same things we are facing and going through as we do church work. I won't bore you with all the details of what happened, but rather share what kind of resonated or touched me when I was going through the conference. One of the things was when they confirmed appointments for the new year, and all the superintendents, district superintendents, with the bishop announced the names of people that clergy that were assigned to churches, and Renae Extrum-Fernandez was assigned to Centennial. When I heard that, I kind of had this feeling that, well, we knew that she was going to be there, but then we don't really think about it enough to know that this is an appointment for another year. And I felt that we should thank Pastor Renae Extrum-Fernandez. We should welcome her again for another year that she has been assigned to us. Although she's been here for some time, they get appointed on a yearly basis. And I think it is on us as members of Centennial Church to thank our pastor, to look after her, because it is on us. Her welfare is on us. That we should show her the love, we should show her the support for the work that she has been called to do. So may I, this morning, Pastor Renae, you know, welcome for this, another appointment for this year. And, you know, we know that sometimes you've probably not been that supportive, but I think I'll be one of those that encourage everybody to support you and all the work that you do. And as she has shared with us this morning, there's that newer direction that her life is being called toward. The episcopal discernment process is going on. There is probably a call out there for greater things for her to do. And I think it is also upon us to be holding her in prayer and in the whole process, that whatever God is doing and calling her to do, I think it's not so much about the position or what is there. I think it's more of the will of God being done. And as you will accept, however we prepare, however we plan or think or wish, it is the will of God that will happen. And we will pray that Renae, as she goes through that process, that we hold her in our hearts, in our prayers, and that we will support her. Thank you all for that. One of the earlier reports that I read was from the church statistician, who kind of gave a grim picture, well, not so grim, but the reality of it, that our church is in decline in terms of numbers, membership. while some may look at that from a kind of a judgmental point of a stance, position, to say, you know, what have we done wrong or what, I like us to think that this is God's urging and calling for us to rethink the way we are doing mission and church. Now, I'm not only talking about the church at this level. At the conference level, that idea is very clear, and that came out very clearly, that the conference is really looking at how do we do things in this new challenging times that we are facing. How do we do church? How do we continue to grow and make disciples in this new and difficult times that the world is going through? And I think that is the message I want to bring to us here at Centennial, that how can we be bold and think about newer ways of doing mission? I think we know how to do church very well. You know, we come to church, we know how to sing, we know the hymns, we know that. What I think is lacking, what we really need to work on, is the mission that we are called to do outside the walls of this church. How will our campus or our church, our vision, accomplish what we are called to do? Church is not just about us. Church is out there. There are people who need to come. So while the picture and the idea of decline and falling numbers is the reality that we are facing, I think it is also the challenge that we must grapple with and deal with, because I think God does not intend for the church to die. I think God intends that the church reinvent itself to meet newer and more people in more relevant ways, relevant to this time and to the culture that is there now. The mission focus areas, our superintendents, it was clear in the conference that everybody's working hard at that top level. Superintendents, everybody. One word that was clearly coming out was collaboration. Collaboration, people working together across offices and across titles, clergy with lay people, that this work needed collaboration. We needed to work together with different agencies and different peoples at different levels. And I think that collaboration is also important to us here at Centennial. We bring it to our level. We need to work with each other to be able to fine-tune. I know our council chair has been working very hard to try and identify a focus area of the mission that we are called to do at Centennial and how we go forth with that. But then we are encouraged not to think of Centennial as Centennial in a vacuum. We belong to a group of other churches. We belong to a circuit. We belong to an area. So, you know, we can work and collaborate with other people with other churches that help us envisage what we need to do. Something that was like burning at the back of my mind was, we've got this idea about our fellowship hall and our kitchen and our education wing that needs to be revamped and perhaps updated. And not only are we thinking about improving and revamping our facilities for the sake of just doing it for us, I think this is an opportunity for us to look at these buildings, their use, and how it is going to be the impetus to the mission that we wish to carry out. I think it's more than us just thinking, how can we improve the kitchen for our own facilities, for our own use, or for our own convenience? Or how do we improve the education building only for our purposes? But I'm thinking that the mission work that we are called to do is to think of improving the things around us for the greater good, for the greater mission, not only for us, but for the people who are outside the walls of this church, who we need to bring in. We're all going through difficult times. Personally, the church itself has been going through a difficult time in terms of its office. As we all know, Bishop Kakanyo's issue is still not resolved yet, and we've got a temporary bishop that's filling in for that, and we don't know when that is going to be solved. It hasn't taken anything away in terms of, you know, the direction the church, the work of the church continues, and it goes on. Which makes the Bible reading that Carolyn read for us, which was the theme of the conference, let love be. Let me start the words, let love be genuine, let love be real. Now, if our work is going to succeed, if our mission or what we intend to do is to succeed, I think those words ring true. We have to exercise that love genuinely. I read Romans 12 a few times before the conference, and then when Pastor Renee, when I realized that I was going to do this little message time today. Romans is usually one of the difficult chapters to read, but then Romans 12, read Romans 12. I read it over and over again, and I'm beginning to love it now. Romans 12 really, very clear, very easy, tells you how to love. When you're doing your work in the church, it teaches you how to do that love. And despite all the difficulties, you know, with all those, the world is saying this is difficult, the church is declining and all that. We all know love overcomes. Love does, overpowers everything. And that real love, let love be. Let love be in all our lives, in all our hearts. And as we carry out this mission, as we think about what we do or what we want to do for the kingdom of God, for the transformation of people's lives, that they become good disciples. You know, I think it needs to start with us, and that we have to make sure that that love is genuine. Let love be. Thank you very much.
Day by day, helping, watching on me, love.
as we present our gifts.
Let us pray. Dear loving God, sometimes we do forget that you are everything to us. Today, as we celebrate our fathers on earth, our fathers who have gone to be with you in heaven, and those who have been a father figure to others, and your love for all humankind, please take these tithes and these offerings and help them be used as you would have them be used. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Something Pamela and Pam Knox and I enjoy is identifying when somehow the Holy Spirit knits the offering of music and the message and the Spirit together. And that happened with Take My Life and Let It Be. Semi said, that's the perfect hymn. So let's sing together, Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Thank you. Semi, let me invite you up for our benediction and Carolyn. Would you like to give the good word or shall I? Shall I? Will you open your hearts to the good word, the benediction?
Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that you call us to be here to give praise and honor to you and your name. Send us forth to go into the world, carrying your word and doing what you will in our lives. Thank you, and we go out in peace and in the love of our Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Carolyn, come in.